Conflicts could be viewed as roadblocks. They don't have to stop you. They don't have to be eliminated totally. One thing that you need to learn is to navigate your way through them or around them to get to the dream destination that you have. My name is Dr. Sara Nasserzadeh. I'm excited to partner with Goop and Porsche in this year's In Goop Health Summit. This is the Drive series. In this workshop, we are going to talk about different types of conflicts, the strategies to manage your conflicts in a healthy way, to be responsive rather than reactive, and a tool to take away with you to help you with any sort of conflicting scenario that you might be experiencing in your life. So we will be talking about mostly intimate partnerships and when to partner when you get into conflict. However, all of these are transferable into any relationship that you find yourself in, with your contractor, with your child, with your parent, with a coworker, whoever that you have a relationship with. Now, why does this concept of conflict management matter? Think of it this way. I break it into two categories. One is, in physics, we have a phenomenon called material fatigue. Imagine this glass, right? So if you keep flicking it over time, like the little annoyances that we have in our relationships on a daily basis, over a period of time, this fatigue factor gets into the glass, and one day I'm not even doing anything, I'm just looking at it, or just puff, and it shatters. And that's what I see in my couples, most of them. So it's really important for you to be able to manage the daily conflicts that you have, those little irritating interactions. That's one. The other reason that I would like to share with you today is the physical alienation that many couples feel. So for example, couples come to me and say, I love my partner, but I'm not in love with them anymore. I so badly want my partner physically, but my body feels like, ew, I don't want to be close to this person. Or another thing is, I have so much resentment, it doesn't allow me to lean forward to my partner. So that bodily alienation is also a piece that is because of the fatigue factor. That's why managing your conflict in a healthy way matters a lot. So now let's see what conflict is, right? How we perceive conflict. If you think of it on an unconscious level and conscious level, here's what we're dealing with. At the unconscious level, the body has an alarming system for us that gives us sensations. And well, the technical term basically is neuroceptions, the way that our nervous system perceives the safety and danger around us in any given moment. The second type of conflict is conscious, and is usually based on sociocultural, a construct of the roles, power dynamics, in any given dynamic that you're in. The idea here is a very sophisticated cognitive processes to not only keep you safe, because that was the primal level, but also look for the actual outcome in that relationship or interaction. And the purpose here is to keep the connectivity between you and the other person in conflict and then move through it. You either resolve it or get to a deeper intimacy level, whatever that the outcome, desired outcome is for you. So it's a more sophisticated cognitive level versus the first one that was pretty primal and just to keep me safe. Now, one thing that I need to be clear about here is, in life, we are not avoiding conflict. What we need to achieve is to actually bring these two levels of primal as well as sophisticated level together to be able to manage conflicts in a healthy way, to build up resiliency, deeper connections, and to basically unlock our potentials in life and in relationships. Now, some strategies to managing your conflicts in a healthy way. The first thing that you need to achieve here is to bring all those neuroceptions, the nervous system's perceptions of safety and danger that are unconscious, to your conscious level, to give yourself a sense of agency in any given moment. So that would be really important. To do that, here are the steps that you can follow. First and foremost, it's important for you to know that emotions come actually after sensations. Many people look for emotions, tracking their emotions. But before that happens sensations. What I'm talking about here is those moments that you feel in your body, you know, there's a contraction. There's like, you know, I'm talking to somebody, it feels like I'm bracing myself as if somebody's gonna punch me in the face. So these are the ones that is really important for you to pay attention to. So notice your sensation. The other one is notice where your energy is coming from. Did I just have a quarrel with my mother before? Did I get a good night's sleep? Did I miss my caffeine dose today, this morning? So check in with your energy. What is the residue of energy that you're bringing to the situation? The third step here for the self-awareness step, it would be for you to realize what sort of emotional state you are in. Check in and track with yourself. Am I annoyed in this situation? Am I offended? Am I uncomfortable, a sense of discomfort that I'm feeling? Am I hurt? Or am I triggered, going from a moment of 0 to 100 just in a split of a second? What is going on with me, emotionally speaking, right? The next step is for you to just take a split of a second and ask yourself, what matters most here? Who is it that I'm fighting with? Just to center yourself. Why am I doing this? Why am I even in this dynamic? The next thing is, if you know your conflict management style, just to make our work easy here, think of three styles. One is net and sword, meaning in a moment of conflict, one person says, come here, casting the net. Come here, we need to solve this problem. The other person pulls out the sword and says, leave me alone, I need space. The other one I call stallions. They're just really strong and come with all of passion and tension and going at each other and exhausted. And then go out and exhausted again. So it's like just offloading on each other just to show how hurt they are, right? So that's a stallion. The other one is the turtles. Nothing happened, go back to your shell. It will resolve itself. Nobody needs to know anything and just push things under the carpet. Think with yourself, just take a moment, which one resonates most with you, and then it will help you. Why? So for example, if you're a net and sword sort of person, if you are in the sword section, you really, really need a space. You feel like, you know, the conflict is really escalating, it's not gonna go anywhere, you have a check-in with yourself, my God, this is the person I love most in the world, why am I doing this? Then you can say, I'm actually pretty worked up. If you don't mind, I'm just gonna go to that room, calm myself down, check in with you in 30 minutes. That's extremely important. Many people do that. However, what they don't do is to put an exact time to come back. I'll check back with you in 30 minutes. That hour is really important because the person with the net is hanging, waiting for you. And then they get to the worst place as you're walking away. They feel abandoned, you know, all that sort of beautiful stuff shows up for them that you do not want. And now you calm down, you want to approach or reapproach the person to actually resolve the conflict and for good and move through it. There are certain aspects that I would like to highlight here. Number one, watch for your language. The way that you frame what just happened is really important. So if I come to you and say, well, we just had a big fight, now let's resolve it. That's very different. Then I come to you and say that we just had a tiff. You know, we had a bickering moment. So you see how this frames it? Because if I come and say that we just had a big fight, it means that even if we resolve it, there needs to be a winner here, right? So it's important to watch how you frame what just happened. And also, don't forget your body. It's extremely important, especially in intimate relationships. So after a moment of conflict, when you are talking it out intellectually and cognitively, make sure that your neuroceptions are very happy and in the safe zone too. The way to do it is not to come and hug each other or pin the person down and say that, hi, honey, I really, really love you, you know, nothing like that. Maybe sitting side by side, really gradually reintroducing the bodies and your nervous systems together, because the body keeps the score that, you know, of any argument or those flicking moments that we have with each other in a relationship. At the end, my friends, instead of lending you a hand, I'm gonna offer you my arm. Remember this. In any moment of conflict, remember a arm. Acknowledge what just happened. Appreciate the intensity of the moment, the hurt that it caused either parties. Reassure, we are in this together. Restate what is common ground. Join the person instead of falling apart. And then mend. That mend could be a single touch. It could be a gesture. It could be a promise that I would never do this intentionally again to hurt myself, you, or the relationship. A, R, acknowledge, appreciate, reassure, and mend. So these were some effective strategies that I wanted you to take away from our workshop today to be more responsive rather than reactive in any moment of conflict in your relationships. If you want to connect with me and join the community to continue the conversation, check out my website. I'm on Instagram, Facebook. You can find me all over the digital world. If you would like to continue this conversation in person, join me on November 7th at the Goop Health Summit at the Porsche Experience Center. See you there.